Hello and welcome to this presentation on image deconstruction. This will be a brief presentation that will talk about the idea of image deconstruction and how it is used in two-dimensional imagery. Really, this comes from working from a source imagery, but it can also be used from direct observation. A little bit about source imagery. If you work from a source image, you should know it's a common practice amongst artists and designers. Some people have a very dogmatic view of source imagery, but that is actually a fairly dated view. Artists have been using source imagery since the Renaissance. What source imagery really does is it provides an advantage in accurately creating imagery without being dependent on having advanced skill sets in drawing and long time frames. In other words, if you're not the world's greatest drawer and you're on a deadline, working with source imagery, in particular source imagery that you have taken yourself, is a really great way of creating an image that is graphically clear and accurate and exactly what you want. This is also a really great way to start to break down imagery and start to learn how to read an image. Form is made of lots of individual parts, and being able to interpret it, understand it, and reorganize it is key to being an effective artist. The more advanced your understanding of things like value, form, and line, which we briefly discussed form and line, we haven't really talked about value yet, the more complex and accurate your images will become. So with that in mind, your image deconstruction processes will get better the more you do in this course. So really, here's a few key questions you need to ask yourself when doing image deconstruction. Where do the shapes belong? Meaning, if I'm looking at an image that there's a cast shadow on something, Where does the shadow end and the light start? You know, those are difficult questions to answer. How do I interpret shadows and highlights? Do I have to have, you know, 7 or 8 highlights and 7 or 8 shadows, or can I just do with 1 shadow and 1 highlight? And does that make a big impact on the quality of the image? And how much detail should I include? There is such a thing as too much or too little detail. And I think that the more experience you get, the better you are going to get at making that decision. If you do this deconstruction right, it probably looks pretty effortless and easy. And I know a lot of complaints I've heard from students is that it looks too easy. There's really nothing easy about it at all. It just looks easy if it's done well. In this digital example that I've done here, I've taken the picture of William Shatner's face from the Star Trek television show. And I've really broken it down into 5 values, which is just the range of dark and light. You can see that some of the decisions I've made are sort of strange. For instance, if we look at all of the darker values here, if you look at the darker values in this area, I'm including his eyelashes, the pupil, and the heavy shadow of his brow all into a single shape. I then take the lighter part of his pupil as its own independent shape. All of these shapes have a unique character, and they're based on direct observation. They're not lazily or quickly drawn. For instance, the shape underneath his eye kind of looks like a dolphin or a whale, maybe, but it really came from following the contour of that shape really carefully and breaking that down. Now, I only took this so far, but I think you can see, just looking at it, it feels fairly accurate. And if we were to zoom out from this image, which I don't have an example of, you would see that it looks increasingly more accurate. Now, you could go further with it, or you could even maybe simplify that further, depending on what you need. If I wanted to cut this out of vinyl on a computer, this would probably be the appropriate amount of detail. If this were a study for a painting, maybe more information would be needed. There's really no way to get every piece of detail in this process. The human face in particular is really complicated with tons of little tiny hairs and defects, and you're just not going to be able to get them all. You have to make some basic decisions on how much information you're going to include or exclude. A great rule of thumb is to squint at the image, and whatever disappears, you didn't need in the first place. So if we go back to the Shatner image, and you squint, just take a second and squint at that, you can see that the boundary between the dark part of his eye, his eyelashes, and his eyebrows kind of all go away. It all sort of melts into one shape, which is really what helped me make that decision in drawing. That process is really important, as the simplification of an image strangely and sort of counterintuitively adds to the realistic detail that you're going to get. Our eyes don't see in 4K. Our eyes see in like 700 DPI. Here's some great examples from some previous projects that I've had in my design classes, although you guys won't be doing this exact project, in which we took magazine cutouts of celebrities. Celebrities was important so that they were recognizable. And we challenged ourselves to break the images down through the image deconstruction process into a small number of shapes that could then be filled in with paint in this case, but it could have been done in ink, and still be recognizable as the image source. And you can see in the first one, this is pink, still very much looks like pink. I don't recall the celebrity here. I'm not really great with models. However, there's really great accuracy between the two. I really liked the shape that they chose here. They chased that medium shadow around the tip of the nose. And it kind of looks strange here in the drawing, but in the painting, it actually looks reasonably accurate. And of course, there's no project that doesn't have Kim involved, right? And this does a really good job. One of the things that I always tell people in this process, if you can't see it, don't fill it in. Our brains know there's another half to her face, but the photograph didn't record it, so you can't draw it in. So this student did a really great job of just leaving that information undefined. And you can also see this really interesting figure-ground relationship where the positive space here being dark and the negative space being light really helps enhance the effect. If they weren't attentive to that, this probably wouldn't have been effective at all. And all of this is usually done through the image transfer process for the grid process. We haven't covered that yet. That is something we're going to cover next week. You're probably already familiar with it. If you're not familiar with it, I recommend maybe familiarizing yourself with it with a couple of videos. We'll cover it next week at any rate. But this process really enables us to use this image deconstruction process accurately and transferably, meaning we can move it from our study on magazines to paper at any scale. So we could scale it up, we could scale it down, there's a lot we can do with it. Okay, so that has been a very basic overview of the image deconstruction process, but hopefully you get the idea. We're going to put this to work in future lessons, not so much in this module, but in future weeks. I just want to give you a heads up so that you know what you're in for. Thanks.